So, can you see my slides now? Okay, just assume that you're able to see the slides. So in this lecture, we will go to introduce the soil properties. The soil is actually the most fundamental materials we need to use for the pavement design. And it's especially important for us to prepare the subgrade layers, do some compactions, and also use some appropriate grain structures for the preparation of the base layer and surface layer. So at the first, we need to know what is soil and how we can classify those soil and then analyze their properties for the implementation of the pavement. So the lecture today is very simple. We will just try to identify how to classify different type of the soils. So first of all, we have to know what is a soil. I believe everyone knows what is a soil, and it's some materials in the ground, and usually will be some unconsolidated earth material. If you go to see the details about the soil, those would be some particles, and the particles will have some gap in between, and they will be filled with the air or with some liquids. The soil can also be some loose agglomerations of the mineral or the organic materials. There will be some materials just placed above the bedrock on the earth. And also it could be some of the earth materials, but if we consider the shale or the rock, those will not be, the shale or the rock will not be the organic, will not be the soil. Just bear with me for 1 minute. I need to remove the using time. It's okay. Okay, and so those would be the materials that we saw on the earth, and we define them as the soil. And usually, when we consider the classification of the soil, we have to classify them based on the particle size or their gradations. And with the particle size and gradations, we can classify the soil as the coarse-grained or the granular soil, which will have relatively larger particles. If the particle size is small, then we define them as the fine-grained or cohesive soil. And if the size is extremely small, then that will be the silt. But we actually have some thresholds to identify what kind of soil should belong to these three groups. And in order to do the classification, definitely we need to do some tests. And there will be two common tests we have to use to identify the to classify the soils, and in order to identify the grain size, the which would be the dimensions of the particles, we need to use two tests. One is the sieve analysis. The other one is the hydrometer test. The sieve analysis will use the sieves with multiple sizes, and then we will try to identify what's the percentage of the particles who are passing through each sieve, and calculate the amount in each sieve, and using this amount to identify the distributions of the grain size. And for those with a very small grain size, we have to apply the hydrometer test, and the hydrometer test can help us to further identify the distribution of the particles with small dimensions. Also, for those particles, for those portions with small dimensions, we have to do another test, which is called the Edberg limit test. It's applied to identify the features of the actually the plasticity of the materials, and also it will try to identify the clay portions of the soils. If you are interested in the details about the three different tests, the sieve analysis, the hydrometer test, and the Edberg limit test, you can go to check these two videos. And those videos tells you the details about how to use this test to identify the grain size distribution of the soil, as well as the plasticity and liquid limit properties. Another test we have to conduct is about the sand equivalent test. This one is used to identify the presence of the clay, to identify what's the portions of the clay presents in the soil. Again, we also have a YouTube video, and you can go to check this video to see how to conduct the sand equivalent test. This would be some of the background information, and it will be very helpful for you to understand the procedures to get the information that we're going to use for the future slides in this class. And regarding to the classification, once we have the information about the grain size distributions, we have identified the portions of the fine grains and also the clay, and also we have find out the properties, plasticity, and liquid limits of the fine portion. Then we need to apply some method to classify different soils. Generally, there are two types of the method applied, which will be the commonly applied in US and Canada. The first one is called the highway, is developed by the Highway and Pavement Engineering from US. It's called the ASTO classification. ASTO here represent the American Association of the State Highway and Transportation Officials. So they have a lot of work about the design of the pavement. One portion is about the classification of the soil. And the other one is from the geotechnical engineering, which is called the Unified Soil Classification System, USCS. And actually both methods are applied in Canada. So we will need to know the details about both methods. In Ontario, we actually have some modifications about this method. We have our own standards. So if we want to know more details, you need to check the Ontario Provincial Standards, which would be the OPSS. This one not only defines the classification of the soil, but it also shows how the pavement or the pavement design method is modified for the Ontario roads. Okay. So those would be the two methods, and for both methods, we have to conduct the required test, the sieve analysis test. This is only applied for the coarse grain soil. We can identify the distributions of the particle with a larger dimension, and then it will integrate with the hydrometer analysis to find out the distribution, the distribution of the particles for the fine grain soil. And in addition, we need to use the grain size distribution, GSD, obtained from this sieve analysis and hydrometer analysis, and the Edberg limit test for the properties of the fine grain soil, and using these two informations to classify different soils. So let's first go to see the grain size distribution. And this figure actually shows the one typical distribution of the granule B material. And if you can recall our previous lectures, the granule B material is generally applied for the subbase layer. So the figure here shows the percentage of fineness passing through different diameters of the sieves. So if we go to see the point here, it indicates that 100% of the particles can pass the sieve with a diameter of 100 millimeters. So it means that no particles will remain in that sieve. They all force filter down to the sieves with a smaller size. And if we go to see this point, it will probably indicate that 80% of the particles were passing through the sieve with the size, with the diameters of 10 millimeters. It means that approximately 20% of the particles will remain in that sieve or the sieves above with the larger diameters. If we go to check the portions of the particles remaining each sieve, which is diameter is changing from large to small in the test, and you can find out the distribution of the distribution of the grain size. This will be shown in this figure, and you can see that for example at this will be some value around the 0.07. Remember that the this one, the horizontal axis is under the log scale. So this is the result which we can get from the sieve analysis, but definitely it's not sufficient. We want to see more detailed distribution even under the even with the particle size or particle size less than 0.01. So with that, we need to think about the hydrometer test. So as what you see that from the previous with this sieve analysis, we only can find out the grain size distribution up to 0.01 millimeters. For the rest, we need to conduct the hydrometer test and find out even the portion of the soil, the particles with even smaller size. So this could be as small as 0.001 millimeters. So it's very accurate. And usually this the hydrometer test is applied for the soils with more portions of the fine grains. So this would be the grain size distribution, we will use this one a lot for the classification of the soils. And also, as we mentioned previously, we have the granular B materials. Usually, for the granular B materials, it will have the relatively larger particles. For the granular B materials, we will have all the particles passing through 150 millimeter sieves. But for the granular A materials, it will be finer. So it will only for the granular A materials, almost all the particles should pass in through the sieve with the diameter of 26.5 millimeters. So it's much finer compared with the granular B material. And of course, with different portions of the particles, with different granular size distribution, their physical properties will be different to support the pavement design. And based on the diameters or based on the size of the particles, we can define different particles in the sea, in the soil. So if the diameter or if the size is between 75 millimeter to 2 millimeter, we define this type of the particles as the gravel. If it's between 2 millimeter and 0.425 millimeter, those would be defined as the coarse sand. And if it's between 0.425 to 0.075, that would be the fine sand. And another thing we have to remember is about the number 200 sieve. The number 200 sieve is almost the finest sieve that we can use for the sieve analysis, which will have the diameter of 0.075 millimeters. And for all the portion that can pass the number 200 sieve, we cannot use the sieve analysis. Instead, we need to consider the hydrometer analysis. And with the hydrometer analysis, we will then be able to identify the silt, clay, and colloidal clay. So those are actually identified based on their size. So if it's larger than 0.002, that's the silt. If it's larger than 0.001, that's the clay. And for the rest, that will be the colloidal clay. So so that's the way for us to define different particles for in the sand. And also there will be one concept that we have to consider. That will be the nominal diameter. Those are for the for all the dimensions that we mentioned here, the diameters we mentioned here, they will all be the nominal diameter, and we will have a detailed definition about the nominal diameter in the future lectures, especially when we are talking about the super pave design. But those will be will have more details in the future lectures. So for the once we have the grain size distribution and we have identified all those materials based on their dimensions or the diameters, we can then use the apply the ASTO method to classify the soil. This method will actually classify the soil into 8 groups, but generally we will consider 7 groups for the mineral soil, and there will be one independent type, that's A8, as the organic soil. So we have A1 to A7. Also some large groups will have subgroups. They will be applied to identify the mineral soils. And as we mentioned previously, we have to conduct the sieve analysis and the Edberg limit analysis. Of course, we also need to think about the hydrometer analysis and just consider as the it will be combined with the sieve analysis to identify the grain size distribution. And also to determine whether the soil is appropriate for the pavement design, we also need to define a group index. This one will quantify whether this material is good enough for the pavement. And usually, we have to consider the grain size distribution and some of the plasticity and liquid limit properties estimated in the Edinburgh limit test. And this group index is estimated based on empirical formula. So it comes from some field data, and then we use some statistical model to fit the field data and then find out the way to calculate the group index. And of course, we will use the group index to identify the feasibility of the material soil for the pavement design, and also we will use that one to identify the subgroups for each major group from A1 to A8 in the ASTO method. Basically, in the ASTO method, we will define the group A1 to A3 as the granular material. It indicates that the particles in this group will have relatively larger size, and we will only have less than 35% of the particles were passing through number 200C. For the rest type of the soils, with more than 36% passing through number 200C, we will use the group A4 to A7. As I mentioned previously, A8 is an independent type as the, for the organic materials. And A4 to A7 will be defined as the CLT clay materials. And we also need to use the liquid limit and plastic index, which will be estimated from the Edinburgh limit test to identify the CLT materials from clay materials. And there will be more details introduced about how to use these properties. So this formula shows the estimation of the group index. Here, F200 is the percentage passing through the number 200 sieves, as what we defined previously. For A1 to A3, it should be less than 35%. And for A4 to A7, it will be larger than 36%. And also we have the liquid limit value, which is from the Edinburgh limit test. We have the plasticity index. It will usually be the difference between the plasticity limit and the liquid limit. If we want to know more details about how to find out the plasticity limit and the liquid limit, you should go back to watch the video that I shared with you previously about the Edinburgh limit test. This one will show you how the details about how to do the test and how to read the results and find out the plasticity limit and liquid limit. And in this formula, the first term is only determined by the liquid limit, and the second term is only determined by the plasticity index. So both of them will be related to the Edinburgh limit test. If we consider the two subgroups A26 and A27, we just need to use the second equation, the second part of the equation, and the first part is small enough that we don't need to worry about. So that's the that's the calculation of the group index. And usually, if we have identified the group index for one soil structure, then we can check whether this soil is good enough for the subgrid. If the index is very small, then we can say that the soil is good for the subgrid. If it's not, then probably we need to add new materials to that area, or we need to consider developing a rigid pavement. So basically, if the group index is zero, then we say that the soil is excellent. If it's less than one, it's also good. If it's between 2 to 4, it's just a fail. If it's larger than 5, let me say that this soil is poor for the subgrid. Then we need to either remove the soil, or we need to consider a different design, the rigid pavement design, or add a thicker subbase layer to support the pavement. Now let's see how we can use the those information, the group index, the grain size distribution, and the liquid limit and the plasticity index to identify the groups from the ASHTO method. So the table here shows the classification, the ASHTO classification. Basically, you need to check two major items. One is from the sieve analysis. So in the sieve analysis, you have to check the percentage passing through number 2 sieve, number 240 sieve, and number 200 sieve. For example, for the class A1, and there will be actually two subclasses. We have A1A and A1B. For A1A, it must have the particles passing through number 200 sieve no larger than 50%. If it's larger than 50%, it means that this might be this might not be in a good soil. It's just some larger rocks. And make sure that the number of the percentage passing through 200 number 40 sieve is less than 30, and passing number 200 sieve is less than 15. And similarly will be applied to the other type of the groups. We have the A1, A2, and A3. So for A2, it's it actually has 4 different subgroups, and each subgroup represents the group index that we were calculated from the previous equations. You can see that for the A2 soil, all the The portion that they have to pass in through the number 200 sieve should be less than 35%. So that's the result from the first first criterion, the sieve analysis. After that, we need to check the portion which is passing through the number 40 sieve. We will put all the part of the materials, the sawyers passing through number 2 sieve, number 40 sieve, and using them to conduct the Edinburgh limit test. And the test will tell us the liquid limit and the plasticity index. So we will then need to check the liquid limit and the plasticity index to further identify the classes of the soil. So for example, if we consider the A24 soil, then the liquid limit should be less than 40 and the plasticity index should be less than 10. So that's the basic method for us to identify the soils from the ASTO method. And the last two rows shows the description of the of each type of the soil. So for A1, it will represent the stone fragments, the gravel and sand. And for A3 will be the fine sand. And for A2, you will usually represent the silty or clay, gravel or sand. Actually, for all these three types of the soils, they will be very good or excellent for the subgrade. But if we go to see the other four type of the materials, four type of the soils defined in ASTO, they are not quite good. Still, we will need to use the two test results, the sieve analysis and the Edinburgh limit test. For A4 to A7, of course, A7 has two different groups. They all required the portion to passing through number 200 sieve be larger than 36%. And then we will majorly focus on the liquid limit and the plasticity index. For example, for A4, the liquid limit is less than 40 and the plasticity index is less than 10. You will see different values for A5, A6, and A7. And in order for us to differentiate A75 and A76, those would be two different soils under the large group 7. For A75, the plasticity index should be less than liquid limit minus 30, and A76 is a PI higher than LL minus 30. So that's the way for us to classify the soil with the ASTO method. And then I will give you one example, and I hope you can all join this the calculation of this example. So assuming that we have the data in this table shows the grain size distribution passing number 2 sieve, 10, 40, 100, and 200 sieves. It shows the passing rate. We also applied the Edinburgh limit test, and we have the liquid limit around 48% and the plasticity limit around 26%. Then we have to determine the class of the soil with the ASTO method. And then based on the classification, we need to calculate the group index to see whether this one is appropriate for the subbase or the subgrade material. So for the for this example, what should we start with? Do you have any ideas about where we can start? Any ideas that you have? Probably I will initiate a discussion and you can join later. So first of all, we need to go to check the table and it shows the details about the classification. From the example, we know that the percentage passing through number 200 sieve is a 69. So so the 69 is actually higher than 36%. So this means that it must belongs to A4 to A7. So it will only be this four type of the Sawyers. Because for this four type of the Sawyers, we have to make sure that the percentage passing number 200 sieve is larger than 36%. So that's the selection. We identify them as A4 to A7. And then the next thing we need to check is the liquid limit and the plasticity index. So in this problem, we have the liquid limit as 48, the plasticity limit as 26. So we have LL as 48 and PL plasticity limit as 26. So the liquid limit is 48, which is larger than 40. So what we can find from this criterion, we will only have these two categories, A5 or A7. For A3 and A4 and A6, both of them will have the maximum liquid limit around 40. So it's not appropriate for us to define this Sawyer. And then we need to find out the plasticity index. The plasticity index, PI, is the difference between the liquid limit and the plasticity limit. So it's LL minus PL. In this case, that will be 48 minus 26. So that is 22. So we have the plasticity index is around 22. So here you can see that the plasticity index is higher than 10. So it's not A5. Instead, it must be one of A7 group. For A7, it has the minimum plasticity index of 11. And we have the value of 22. And now the last step we have to do is identify whether it's A75 or A76. So we need to check this condition. We know that the PI is 22 and LL is 48. So LL minus 30 is actually 18. And it's smaller than plasticity index. So this means that it is the A76 group Sawyer. So what do we find that this Sawyer is A76. So that's the way for us to identify the Sawyer with the Astill method. And of course, it's in the clay Sawyer. And the next thing we need to check is identify whether this group is appropriate for the subbase material or the subgrade material. And now we know that we have this sieve analysis, we have this grain size distribution. We need to calculate the group index in order to identify whether this one is appropriate. What do we find that the material is A76, that's what we get from the previous page. And now we can list the equation of the group index. That is F200 minus 35 times 0.2 plus 0.005 times liquid limit minus 40 plus 0.01 times F200 minus 15 times plasticity index minus 10. So in this equation, and also based on what we received from the assumption, what's the value of F200? Do you have any idea about what's the value of F200? Yes. So F200 represents the percentage passing 200 CU. So in this case, that's 69. And the liquid limit, it's the value that we obtained from the assumption, that is 48. We also calculate the plasticity index, that is 22, when we classify the material. So we have Pi equal to 22. And now, do you know how to calculate this one? I'll just let you finish the rest. And also give me a suggestion about how whether this one is appropriate for the subbase or the subgrade material. Any idea about what's the value of the group index?
Is it 428.48?
That's a little bit far away. Usually, the group index is less than 20. Probably there will be some value that or some points that you get something wrong when you do the calculation. So we have the F200 as 69 minus 35 times 0.2 plus 0.005. LL is 48 minus 40 plus 0.01 times 69 minus 15. And PI is 22 minus 10. So do this calculation, the result is 14.6. It's some value below, usually it's some value below 20 at most of the situation. So if I get this value, 14.6, what do you think, how will you evaluate this soil, this type of the soil? Is it good for the subgrade or subbase material? Or it's not, and the what kind of category? Yes, the answer is very poor. So if we go to see the there's the table. So we have to use this table to check whether it's in the rate. What's the rating there? It's between 10 and 20, so it's very poor. Usually, we have to choose the materials or the soils with the group index less than 1 in order to provide a reliable pavement. So that's the example for us to categorize the material with the soil with the ASTO method. And the other one is called the Unified Soil Classification System, USCS method. I'm not quite sure whether I can finish all the topic today, but I will try my best. And if you have any questions, just raise your hand, and I'm here to waiting for to answer all the concerns you have. So for the USCS method, basically, we will also consider the grain size. We need to think about the distribution, so the grain size, and we also need to think about the categories of the particles and combine them together. The USDA system will categorize different soils. So basically, we will have the similar definition to the ASTO method. It defines the gravel, sand, silt, and clays based on the dimensions of the particles. For each type, it also has a threshold to classify the coarse materials and fine materials. For the sand, it has the coarse, medium, and fine. And if the dimension is too high, then like if dimension is higher than 300 millimeters, that will be the borders. And if it's larger than 75 millimeters, that will be the cobblers. And all those actually comes from the sieve analysis. And of course, we need to conduct the hydrometer analysis. So this would be the size of the particles for the USCS method. And the next thing we need to do is like how the USCS method is applied to categorize the soil. Basically, this type of system will apply a two-letter system to identify the particles. We will need to use the particles, the soil's properties from the sieve analysis, the hydrometer analysis, and also the adiabatic limit analysis. For the definition of different types, it has two letters. The first letter defines the soil, which is used to identify the type of the soil, whether it's in the gravel, the sand, the silt, clay, organic, or peat, depending on the size of the particles. And the second letter will represent the property of the soil. So it can show the liquid limit property. H represents a high liquid limit, L represents low liquid limit. So high means that L is larger than 50, and low represents the value is less than 50. And also it could be the value of the fine component. If it's M, it means that it's a silty. If it's a C, represent it's a clay. And also we have to consider the gradation symbols. It's whether W represented the well grained and P represent the poorly graded. With these definitions, we can then put these two symbols together. For example, if we have the soil SW, it will represent S is the sand, represent sand, the soil symbol, and W represent the property of the soil. If you go to the right side, you can find W is the well graded. So SW represent well graded sand. And similarly, if you go to CSC, so S is sand, C is the clay, so that's the clay sand. And you can apply different combinations of those with these two letters, and that will be different classes of the soil defined by USCS. And I think I don't have enough time to continue this topic, so I will just stop here. Do you have any questions or concerns about these lectures and also the lab experiments?
Hello, Professor.
Yes.
I saw last week you posted, you mentioned that there's a homework zero.
Yes, the homework zero will be posted. I actually have created the homework zero. I can post it today. The due time for the homework zero is next Thursday. I actually can tell you the question. The homework zero is actually a bonus question. You have all attended the tutorial session today, and the tutorial session tells you what kind of distresses, what kind of common distresses apply to the payments, different type of the payments. So in the homework zero, wants you to take a picture about the some of the distresses on the road in your neighborhood, and do identify those distresses and analyze the potential reasons. So once you have done this, we will try to check whether your answer is correct or not, and depending on your performance, there will be 2 bonus points to your final grade. It's just a warm up for you to get familiar about the payment design class. It's a class which will be highly related to our realistic, our real life, and you will see all the payments on the roads, and if you drive your car, you will experience what's the performance of different type of the payments.
I see. Thanks.
The homework sheet will be assigned tonight. Okay. Let me see whether there's anything in the for those who choose the online and accidentally put you as the in person, that'll probably be my fault, and I'm just trying to try my best to organize everything. So I will correct the group list, and if you see anything wrong in that group list, email me and I will do the modification and always update the list. So we will try, if you want to do the modification, please send me email as early as possible, because we need to finalize the list and also the schedule of the lab experiments. Okay. So if that is clear, and I guess that will be all about the lecture today. And okay, I think that's it. Thank you very much for your time, and feel free to send me email if you have any questions and concern. And if no, then I will close the meeting today, and I will see you tomorrow.